Why can't I smoke? Because this doctor is a film for young people. All right, so I can't smoke. What do you want me to speak about then? Whatever you want. For example, about the fact that you were wearing a red jumper that day. Or about flowers. Yes, let's talk about the flowers. What flowers? Let me smoke. About being sent flowers on every anniversary. About not knowing who sends them. 32 bouquets so far. 31. In 68, I didn't receive any flowers. It made me sad, but the very next year I got them again. And I still get them to this day. Once it was marsh marigolds, last year roses, this year daffodils. The flowers are always yellow. Is that what we should be talking about? Yes. You never know which insignificant detail may one day become a symbol. I always stood by this concrete post. I was a hospital courier at the time, and that was my job, to stand by the gate at the Umschlagplatz and lead the sick out. 6 weeks running, I stood like that. Our people filtered out those who needed to be saved, and I was singling them out as the sick ones. Before the war, you were a nobody. So how did it happen that 3 years later you were already in the headquarters of the Jewish Combat Organization? It wasn't me who was meant to be there. It was supposed to be... Well, anyway, let's call him Adam. Very brave. But he lost his girlfriend and it broke him. It happened basically without a word, overnight. He just stopped functioning. And when the first meeting of the headquarters was due, he was no longer fit to go there. So I went. We had various ideas. Let's throw ourselves on the walls. All of us, however many there are, let's sit on the walls of the citadel in rows and wait until we're surrounded and they shoot us one by one, row by row. No way! Let's burn the ghetto down, right now! Let's all burn together with them. Let the wind spread our ashes. Let's vote! The majority was in favor of the uprising. After all, mankind has agreed that dying with arms in hand is more glorious than dying without it. It was all about choosing how to die. How much did you pay for the revolver? Between 3,000 and 15,000. The closer we got to April, the more expensive it got. The demand on the market was higher. And what was the price for hiding a Jew on the Aryan side? 2,000, 5,000, depending on whether the person resembled a Jew, whether they spoke with an accent, and whether they were a man or a woman. So for the price of one revolver, you could hide one man for a month, or two, or three. You could also buy off one Jew from a blackmailer. And if you were then faced with this choice, one revolver or a life of one man, we weren't given that choice. Maybe it's for the best. Do you feel remorse? Look, when they were building the housing estate, they demolished the old wall and now there's a new one, from healthy white brick. There are even flower boxes. Dr. Marek Edelman. He would always come to the department when the professor was operating on his patients. And yet he's often full of doubts, like now, for example. He's concerned about what the professor has clamped. The vein or the artery? Ladies and gentlemen, we're stitching up. What if it was a vein? The first images appear in his mind. The oxygenated blood, which, as he knows from school, flows through the arteries, could be diverted from the aorta directly into the veins, which are unobstructed since they're not affected by the atherosclerosis, so they do not cause a heart attack. Edelman sketches all night. Again. Aorta, vein, aorta, vein, oxygenated blood, aorta. Just where is the used blood supposed to drain? We carried out tests on the hearts of the corpses and the blood flowed out through other venous connections. But this is just a model, doctor. How will a living heart behave? Professor, we have a heart attack, some VIP, he's unconscious. Thank you. This is the last chance. The bloodstream must be reversed. The Jewish combat organization in charge of the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising has rejected the German ultimatum to lay down arms by 10 a.m. on Tuesday. The Germans introduced field artillery, tanks and armored troops into the battle. The siege of the ghetto and the struggles of the Jewish fighters are almost the only topics of conversation in a city of millions. Fire! It's over. We're done for. They're going to burn us alive. Calm down. I didn't know what I was doing. People should always think that someone is in charge. That someone knows what needs to be done. Let's go. When a house is on fire, the floors burn first, and then beams fall from above. But several minutes pass between one beam and the next. And that's when you should run. They set us on fire from all sides. We won't get through. They'll shoot us, every last one of us. We can't keep standing here. You either come or you stay here on your own. As you wish, Zygmunt. Do you think one should talk about such things? I don't know what you mean. Those boys I left in the yard. Do you want to ask me if I feel remorse for letting them stay? I don't want to. I don't. But I never stop feeling sorry nonetheless. Let's talk a bit more about the spotlight, jumping over the wall, something like that. Well, it was all happening so fast after all. We were running somewhere. Then someone died. And then we were running again. There was an operation by a home army group by the wall on Bonifraterska Street, but it failed. All right, let's not stand here like that. Where should we go then? People should think that someone knows. How many of you were there? 200. Others say 500, 600 even. No, there were 220 of us. But can't you all really understand it doesn't matter anymore? I do understand. I'm trying to understand. What about those who boarded the trains? They're regarded as inferior, aren't they? They're worse because they didn't shoot? Everybody thinks so. A professor from America visited me recently. He said we walked like sheep to the slaughter. But tell me, is the death of people who perish in silence worse? It's easier for us to look at a man dying in a shootout than at a man digging a hole for himself. My child, I beg of you, write this down. These people walked peacefully and with dignity. This is far more difficult than shooting. It's much easier to die in a shootout. The professor is not keen on operating on the hearts of intellectuals. An educated person tends to think too much, and that's not good for the pulse. The thing is, Edelman said we can proceed with the surgery. I don't understand. He agreed, after all. Marek, you need to understand him. If Żewulski dies, there's nothing strange about it. But if he dies after the surgery, they will judge the professor as a doctor who performs hasty experiments. No. He was brought to us not to die, but to be saved, to live. Professor, no one but you can perform this surgery. Will the patient die if we don't operate on him? This is the second heart attack, Professor. The second extensive infarction. We're not in a position to treat this man. You want me to perform a surgery that has never been successfully performed on anyone before. All I'm saying is that even the smallest chance of survival is vital. We can't waste it. The war has ended. A war that was victorious for everyone else but me.
Ale dla mnie to była przegrana wojna.
It was a lost war, and I kept thinking that I still had to do something, to go somewhere, that someone was still waiting for me and needed to be rescued. I was driven from town to town, from country to country, but when I arrived, it turned out that no one was waiting and there was no one left to help, and that there is nothing to do. So I laid down on my bed and stayed that way. I slept for weeks. I have signed you up for medical studies. Ladies and gentlemen, today's lecture will be devoted to the significance of a quick diagnosis in the case of a heart attack. What can help a doctor? If a doctor knows what a sick person's eye looks like, what a sick person's skin looks like, what a sick person's tongue looks like, then they should know what that sick person actually suffers from. I liked that. I thought that a person's illness was like a scattered jigsaw puzzle. If you put it together right, you'll know what's inside the person. And then I came to the realization that, as a doctor, I could still be responsible for human lives. Everything else seemed less important to me. What is it that no one asks me about the survivors? They only ask about those who died. You survived. Why? I don't know. On one occasion, I was shot at by an SS man, over a dozen times, each time about a half a meter to the side. Maybe he suffered from astigmatism and missed. And that's it? The German wasn't wearing corrective lenses? I don't know. Stop bothering me. Why am I alive? Coincidence? Someone decided that I should live? None of us looked like that. We didn't have rifles, ammunition bags, or maps. Besides, we were black and dirty. The tombstone shows it the way it should be. clear and beautiful. This is where they buried everyone who had died before the ghetto was liquidated. From hunger, typhus, exhaustion. In the street, in abandoned flats. Every day, employees of the Eternity Society collected dead bodies from the streets, put them on trolleys and walked this way along the alley, towards the wall. That's what it really looked like. Do you like racing against death? That's my role. The Lord wants to extinguish the candle, and I have to promptly shield the flame, taking advantage of his momentary lapse of concentration. A race against God? That's audacious. When a man escorts others to death trains, he may have a few things to settle with God afterwards. Everyone passed me by as I stood at the gate, from the first day to the last. Everybody. 400,000 people passed me by. I used to sit under the palm tree, where I could see the rooms where my patients were lying. You know, those were the old days when we didn't have the drugs, treatments, or apparatuses that we have today, and most people in those rooms were condemned to death. One day, under this palm tree, I realized that this was actually the same job as I had there, at the Umschlagplatz. Even when the surgery ends successfully, you wait. There are long days of waiting because it remains to be seen whether the heart will adapt to the pieces of veins, to the new arteries and drugs. Then you gradually calm down. And when that tension and this joy leave you completely, then, only then, you realize what sort of proportion it is. 1 to 400,000. Simply ridiculous. But each life represents a whole 100% for every human being. So maybe it makes some sense after all.